everybody.
Good morning.
I'm going to share a greeting with you, and when I say it, you're probably going to think I've lost my mind, but happy Easter. And I say that to remind you that Easter is not a day. Easter is a season in our calendar year. Our Christian year has a season of Easter. And if you look in your bulletin, it says second Sunday of Easter, not after Easter. So from now until June, I think it's the 9th, we will be celebrating the season of Easter, reminding ourselves that as children of God and people of the resurrection, that we are called to proclaim the good news. So indeed, happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
I would like to share a couple of announcements with you. First of all, the date calendars are available for you to pick up. Check out those dates and plug yourself in where you can. The men are selling barbecue butts. What's the pickup date?
The
19th.
The 18th.
18th, okay. So see any of our Methodist men for an order. There is no youth meeting tonight, and Wednesday night our church council will meet after our Bible study. Are there other announcements that need to be shared, Craig?
If anyone's got any like long 6 to 8 foot angle iron pieces, pretty strong, so I'm gonna put those handicap signs back out.
Okay.
That came up, and something that like you see on the side of the street type of.
Alrighty.
Anyone's got
some angle irons for Craig. Our new upper room devotional books are available in the entry there for starting May 1st, which is Wednesday. Other announcements? If not, we'll begin our time together as our acolyte brings in the light and the love and the warmth of the Holy Spirit as we prepare ourselves for a time of worship. May this time of worship, reflection, and celebration be a worthy response to your love and your sacrifice that you have given for us. Help us to set aside all the distractions of our lives and the chaos of the world so that we might be fully present during this sacred time together. This we pray in the name of our resurrected Lord. Amen.
Morning. It's the opening hymn. It's on page 327 in our United Methodist Hymnals. Singing verses 1, 2, and 4 of the Battle Hymn of Many Prayers.
sanctuary.
Praise God for his mighty firm.
Praise God for his mighty deeds.
Praise God for his exceeding greatness.
Praise God with trumpet sound.
Praise God with lute and harp.
Praise God with tambourine and dance.
Praise God with strings and harp.
Praise God with sounding cymbals.
Praise God with clashing cymbals.
Let everything that breathes praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
If you'll turn with me, we'll affirm our faith using the Ancient Apostles' Creed found on 881 in your handout. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Must we see you in order to believe you, Lord? Is seeing truly believing? Are we to be prisoners of our senses, distrusting and rejecting whatever we cannot see, touch, or hear? Yet you are faithful. You give sight to the blind. You carry us when we are weary. You call us to your side. The locked room of our hearts opens at the turn of your key. Speak your words of life to us again. Do not doubt, only believe. Speak your words of life that we might live. Amen. Words of assurance. The peace of God be with you. Receive God's forgiveness and the promise of the Spirit, for Jesus is risen from the dead. Thanks be to God. Amen. We come now to a time where we share our joys and concerns, and a great, great joy is that we have two of our travelers back with us. It is so good to have y'all back here where you belong. I'm so glad. We live as we do weekly, our Everett and Isabella, Kate and James Perry. We lift Marilyn as she is still recuperating from her surgery. I talked to Pam last night. Kristen Lockhart's mother is having some serious health issues, so we lift Patty Jenkins in prayer. Virginia Hill needs our prayers for healing as she is experiencing some illness as well. And I would lift to you as people of faith, our brothers and sisters across not just our country, but across our world, who are not feeling safe in their own houses of worship. It doesn't matter your faith, your denomination, we should find sanctuary in our sanctuaries. And the violation of that, I know, is troublesome to me, as it should be to all of us. So I pray for peace to come between these people of different faiths. We have a couple of unspoken needs in our faith family, and I would lift to you the broken places of our community, our world, our people, people who are broken, places who are broken, broken families, just that a blanket of peace and comfort might cover them. Are there others? Voice of prayer for our faith family members who joined us last week but aren't here this week. Will you pray with me? God of sun and rain, Lord of love and life, we come this morning seeking to be in your holy presence. As we sit here in this sacred space, I pray that you would calm our busy minds and fine-tune our focus so that we might be more fully present and experience this time of worship in new and refreshing ways. God, as we breathe in, may we be filled with your Holy Spirit. And then as we exhale, let us expel our doubts and our worries. God, we come this morning filled with a sense of thankfulness for your grace and mercy, your faithfulness, and all the many ways that you bless us for food and shelter, friends and family, for meaning and purpose, and yes, Lord, even for the times of struggle and trial. We lift your holy name and give you thanks and praise. Let us never take any of these blessings for granted. Let us live in a constant state of thankfulness. God, so many names and situations have been lifted to you that need your healing presence. In this quiet moment, we lift others to you now. Take each of these, Lord, and provide the healing and hope, love and light. And where and when we can be your ambassadors of healing, Lord, use us. Show us how to be instruments of love and peace. Push us as a church, as your beloved children, as people of faith, to stand up for justice, to speak for those without a voice, to love the unlovable, to help carry the burdens of those who are weary, and to shine light into darkness. Guide us, direct us, empower us, and send us. And God, we lift our voices together now as we pray the prayer that your risen Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our hymn of faith is number 420, not the number printed in your bulletin. 420, breathe on me, breath of God. come on up. Y'all are the representatives today.
Out yet. So think about, I know this has to be your favorite, so On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together, the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." And now Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them, with the disciples, when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach your hand in and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which were not recorded in the book. But these were written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. This is the word of God to the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Gary and Jacob. You've probably all heard the phrase, "seeing is believing," right? It's a common phrase that we use in our culture, and we all know what that refers to. It means that for us to fully accept something to be true, we have to see it with our own eyes. And that's not an unusual thing in our world today. Because there's one thing about the society we live in, it is a culture of skepticism. It's a world where we tend to doubt before we believe. And when it comes to just about anything, we want to be proof. We want proof. Show us what you're talking about. And when we talk about proof, we pretty much mean we want a physical, tangible, even scientific proof that it's real. That's one of the reasons why many people say they can't believe in God. Sort of what Ginger was sharing with the kids. They can't see it. They can't touch it. So they say they don't believe it. And they say things like, "You cannot give me physical evidence or proof that God exists, so I can't believe." They doubt. And our scripture reading that Portner read this morning tells us about someone who had doubt. It was Thomas. Doubting Thomas, we call him. This nickname has stuck with this disciple Thomas ever since that story that Portner read to us. The passage tells us that the disciples were gathered together, meeting together. And oftentimes when we read that, we think that they're talking about the 10 remaining disciples. 10, because Thomas wasn't there. But if we read in Acts chapter 1, verse 14, we find out that it wasn't just that core group of disciples. We find out that the women, Mary, Jesus' mother, Jesus' brothers, and probably many others were there in the upper room together. This group of disciples was kind of laying low, hiding out, if you will, fearful of what might happen to them if they went out into public. They were gathered there, it says, Portner read, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders. Now think about it. children had fled the scene in fear of their own lives, even denied having known him. And now they were hiding out for their own safety. They feared the Jewish leadership. They feared that they would come after them because they had been followers of this man, Jesus. You can imagine it was an incredibly tense time. If they had killed Jesus for treason, they might come after the ones who had followed him, his followers, his students, the ones who had been at his feet listening and learning to what he had taught. But then we read something very unusual happens. Verse 19 said, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Somehow, Jesus was able to enter that locked room, stand right there in their presence, and give them just a common greeting of the time. Now, put yourself there. Can you imagine the shock that the disciples felt? I can't imagine. The one that they had run away from on the night of his arrest is now standing right there in front of them. To say they were surprised would be an understatement, I'm sure, but maybe they were a little afraid, too. Afraid of maybe the scolding they were going to get from their teacher. And maybe there was some shame, too. Shame for their own abandonment of their leader when he needed them the most. But instead of a reprimand or a scolding, Jesus says to them, "Peace be with you." And then after greeting them, Jesus holds out his hands and says, "Look, see my hands," and showed them his side where he had been pierced. And with that, it seems that the disciples' shock and surprise and fear just dissolved away. Because verse 20 says, the disciples were overjoyed when they saw that. When they saw those marks on his hands and on his side, they knew that that was truly him. It wasn't just some ghost or apparition or some sort of vision. It was really Jesus. Their Jesus. He had, in fact, risen from the grave. They shared their rejoicing, and again, Jesus says to them, "Peace be with you." But this time, he follows it up with a job he needs them to do. He goes on to say, "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with these words, Jesus commissions them to do his work. The Father had sent him, and now in turn, he commissions them to carry on the work that he had started. But he doesn't stop there. He breathes on them the Holy Spirit to lead them and empower them in carrying on his work. Can you imagine sitting there and having that happen? This happens just 3 days after they had seen their Jesus crucified. They had just witnessed their teacher being beaten and tortured. They had watched him suffering. They watched him die on that horrible cross. And they saw his side pierced with a sword. And they had seen his bloody, lifeless body just hanging there on that cross. And they had witnessed his limp, dead body being lovingly, carefully taken off the cross and laid in a tomb. And now, just a few days later, he's standing right there in front of them and greeting them like it's nothing. "Peace be with you." And then they felt his breath and received a commissioning, an important job to carry on the work of the Savior. But oh, poor Thomas. I can relate to Thomas. He missed it. He wasn't there. perform? How can somebody just up and rise from the dead on their own power? It's not possible. It would be hard to accept, right? So I think maybe we shouldn't be so hard on Thomas. And then we read in the scripture that a week later, they're gathered again here in this house, and again, the doors are locked, and this time, though, Thomas was with them. And I wonder if he was afraid of missing out again. Last time I didn't hang with the guys, I missed out. We read again that Jesus appears to them. Doors are locked. And suddenly Jesus comes and stands among them and again says, "Peace be with you." Imagine what's going through Thomas's mind at this point. Wow. They weren't kidding. They were right. I can't believe it. I mean, I see it with my own eyes, but is it truly him? And then Jesus turns and speaks specifically to Thomas. "Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Thomas, stop doubting and believe." Now, Jesus knew what Thomas had said to the other disciples. So he tells him to do exactly what it was Thomas said he needed to believe. When Thomas hears what Jesus says, he declares, "My Lord and my God." 5 short words that have a lot of meaning to it. Because the word Lord in that statement is equivalent to the Old Testament word of Yahweh, which is the name of God himself. And then he says, "And my God." Thomas in that statement is making a divine claim. Not only is he saying, "Yes, Jesus is my master and my teacher," but in fact, Jesus is God himself. Thomas understands that the act of Jesus' resurrection truly shows that Christ is God himself. Thomas knew that since Jesus was in fact alive, since he had been risen from the dead, that Christ was fully divine. What a tremendous statement of faith by the person who many people describe as a doubter. The person who throughout history has been labeled with this derogatory nickname, Doubting Thomas. He's the one with the declaration of faith, "My Lord and my God." Now, Jesus doesn't stop and commend him or affirm what Thomas says. In fact, what he says is probably more like a gentle reprimand of Thomas's doubt. There aren't any harsh words, and he doesn't put Thomas down, but he does say, "Because you have seen me, you believe." Okay, I think that's fair enough. Those who saw Jesus after the resurrection probably did believe because they had seen him with their own eyes. But then Jesus goes on to say, "Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe." And there are many, many followers of Christ who through the centuries would believe without seeing. Jesus commends Thomas while rebuking him, but then he gives a blessing to those who don't have to see it to believe it. And then at the end of the reading Fortner shared with us, there's two kind of unusual verses that don't exactly seem like they go with the story. But John is wrapping up with these two important verses. He tells us why he wrote the gospel. It says, "These are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. John wrote his gospel to people who probably never saw Christ himself. John wrote that gospel for us. He knew that there would be people with doubt and questions about Christ. Those who received John's gospel had never had that opportunity as the disciples did to see the miracles, to see the resurrected body. They never got to hear the words, the teachings of what Jesus said. But John wrote it all down so that people would hear about who Jesus was, that they might believe in him, and that they might have life in him. This is the difficult part for many people today. They can't see Jesus. They can't see his hands, put their hands in his side. And so it makes it hard for them to accept the fact that he died and was raised from the dead. For us today, we have to rely on what was said this a few minutes ago, those God winks, God moments, love letters from God, I call them. That's where we see Christ alive and well. And we have to depend on the stories of others, our faith family members, the stories of the Gospels, their testimony. Because remember, Jesus said, blessed are those who have not seen, and yet they believe. As I said in the beginning, and as we all know, we live in a culture that wants and demands proof, just like Thomas. For him, seeing was believing. But you don't have to see to have faith. And that's what believing without seeing is, faith. We read in Hebrews, now faith is being sure of what we hope for, and certain of what we do not see. We can and we should believe without seeing. We believe that Jesus did in fact die on that cross for each of us. We believe that he did in fact defeat sin and death. And because of what Christ did, we believe and can confidently hold on to the fact that we one day will be with our Creator and our loved ones who have gone before us. And we look forward to this because Christ defeated death once and for all. We don't have to see it to believe it, because Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Amen. Many ways that you do provide for us. We return a portion of those gifts back to you now. We ask that you take them, use them, multiply them, that we might be a part of the kingdom building here on earth.
Thank you.
morning's opening hymn will be on page 451, Feed on My Vision, singing all three verses.
Work. To God be the glory.